we will now move on to a panel session. May I please invite on stage Sita Ananthashivan? She will be moderating the panel.
As Devindashi ji said, and we all know, when you cut down a tree, GDP grows up. So is it possible to have an economic growth or economic model where a living tree will have a more value than a dead tree? A living tree, can it help us to have an economic growth?
Okay, I'll probably just get the conversation started, and this is from a pure economics angle. The entire thing about GDP, I think you can just change the way that GDP is computed. So you have something called net domestic product, which basically will take into account depreciation. One of the modern kind of thinkings about that is to, you know, just don't talk about depreciation of physical assets, but also depreciation of the environment. And once you do that, you can actually have, I think, a very good understanding of the amount of natural resources that has gone down each year and how much of output is produced. You kind of net those two things and you get a good idea. So if you're in fact cutting down far too many trees for let's say output, which is not commensurate with that, that is in fact, you know, giving less value to the dead tree than the living tree.
You know, when I was talking about the way natural resources are left out, you know, much of the economics today derives its inspiration from Adam Smith, who wrote that Wealth of Nations, but perhaps he forgot to talk about natural wealth. He talked about everything else. And that is why they need the fact that he left out nature and the ecosystem services that it provides. I think there is a desperate need to really reevaluate or evaluate the natural resources or the ecosystem services the nature provides, and then you see whether this is economically viable or not. Now, normally what happens is there is a mining project, let's say in the Himalayas, and the company would come and say, "Oh, we are going to make an investment of $200 million." And that would mean generate so much of employment and so on and so forth. But if you were to able to work out the ecosystem services that mountain provides, then perhaps you could know what is the real wealth of the real value of that natural resource that you're going to destroy. Let me give you an example. The Kailash Parbat is one of the religiously very important place to visit. But do we know the economic value of Kailash Parbat? Somebody will come tomorrow and say that, oh, this is Kailash Parbat, I'm going to invest $200 million or $300 million, and that will be looking very attractive to anyone. The chief minister would be very happy to offer that to the government, but now, or to the company. But now there are economists who have worked out the economic value of Kailash Parbat. So for the first time, you get to know what is the economic value of a natural resource. And I think that is something we need to really encourage now. Then only you can put that kind of a growth model into place.
One has to be careful with this. The World Bank in 2013 did a study of, several dozen developing countries, and India was one of them. And what it did was to track the decline of natural assets, that is to say forests, water, and a few other things. I think there were the four major parameters, human health damages from air and water pollution and so on. And just on four parameters, they found that on an annual basis from the early 70s up until 2013 or something, you had to take away 5.7 percentage points annually from GDP, effectively neutralizing all the famed growth of the last 50 years, right? Now, if you add more parameters, you might find that you're getting rid of 8 or 9 or 10% of your GDP, percentage points from your GDP, which means you're growing negatively. And that's the reason that sort of accounting is simply not done. Or if it is done, it is certainly not reported, because it will delegitimize the growth project around the whole planet if you actually take it seriously. So I think this is very important. The other point which I think is important to keep in mind is the danger in the valuation of nature along monetary lines, is that you are actually ignoring three major constituencies structurally in the way you do it, and you can't change this, you can't improve upon this, and I'll explain why. So first of all, children are not part of your valuation, okay, because they are not of voting age, okay. Secondly, the unborn are not part of your valuation. You don't know how they are going to value things in the future. Your valuations are all contingent upon present generations' perceptions, their knowledges, which are always, you know, inadequate to the task. And thirdly, very, very importantly, non-human entities and beings who might have their own judgments about what's of value and what is of, you know, what is not of value are out of the equation altogether. And you're ignoring these three major constituencies in doing whatever valuation you're doing as adult and omniscient human beings living in the present moment of history, not here to stay forever. So I think that those caveats are extremely important. And related to this is the corollary of that, which is that just because you can show something to be economically justified does not mean that you should actually go ahead and do the project. There's a whole set of other things that you need to look at, and those numbers may not tell you a lot of the story that is relevant. So I think, you know, this is the problem with green accounting, both on the plus side and on the minus side. And let's not forget that GDP was invented for a very specific purpose in the early 20th century when it was invented, and Simon Kuznets, who produced the first national account series, the main use to which it was put was to find out who has more battleships, who has the capacity to make more aeroplanes, basically to compare military hardware across countries during world wars and so on. That was the original purpose of GDP. It serves that purpose rather well.
In this debate between ecology and economics, how is it the economists are pretending they know anything? Because economics is a part of ecology. Ecology is not a part of economics. Economics is a subsidiary science. Ecology is the mother of everything. And I can't see how economists can say we have the tools to understand what is the value of a particular ecosystem. That's not done. It's if you take certain ecological assets that we have, they're totally priceless. Now, we try to examine what is the value of an underground aquifer. What is the value? Because in mining, we faced it in Goa, that people had completely disrupted aquifers, which were several centuries old, to get to the ore. So we said, now, we want to get that compensated. And they said, you can't, because we've got no tools to compensate what would be the value of an underground aquifer. Now, that's what I say. If you don't have a monsoon, for example, you don't have agriculture, you don't have economy. But if you don't have economists, you still have survival and human beings and agricultural productivity. And so I just wanted to bring my reservations about.
I'd like to just add on here. When I was a reporter, I remember I went to cover a cement plant in Himachal Pradesh. And the general manager of the company said, "What's your problem? I'm slicing this mountain, and one day it's going to be disappearing. So when the mountain is not there, what ecology you are talking about?" So I can understand why he said that. But I think in today's the kind of discussion that we are having on environmental issues, on ecological issues, as well as on economics, it is very important to ascribe a value. Why I feel so is because in this debate, there is no other immediate factor that can counter that threat that we face from modern economists. And so it is an evolving science. It's an evolving, I think the data that was earlier, evolved, or let's say was available 2-3 years back, as far as the ecosystem services were concerned, has been improved a lot, because there are globally scientists working on it and so on and so forth. I'm saying, I agree that it's not perfect. There are a lot of things to be included, but I think when I look back the 5-year-old data and the data now that is available, on the basis of which a team of us actually had gone into and produced a kind of ecosystem services the farmer protects in this country, which we are trying to say that this is the minimum income that a farmer must get also, which also includes the cost of, let's say, environmental destruction that he does by pulling out excessive water and so on. That farmer should be made to pay pay for it, but at the same time, the other ecological services that the farmer is protecting needs to be protected. And I think in a paper that few of us published in, together published in EPW, we worked out an average monthly cost that the farmer must be paid was at something around 14,000 rupees. But it's still evolving. We know that there are gaps there, but at least it has given a kind of a picture as to kind of biological or biodiversical or biodiversity protection that the farmer has undertaken all these years.
The Supreme Court has done it. I mean, NPV, the entire discussion as Kanchan Chopra committee, everything has gone there. They have collected money from people to destroy forests for compensatory afforestation and net present value and ecosystem services, and they're keeping it in these pathetic banks. That nobody is using that money for restoring forests. Goa government has got 100 crores of compensatory afforestation fund for 10 years and has not used even one rupee. So we have lost the forest. The economists are protected, they are tough. But we have lost the forest and we are not getting them back. And we have got the money which is losing value at 10% every year. So after 10 years, that value also 10,000 crores will be worth nothing. So we'll have neither that, nor the trees, nor the forest. Thank you. I don't want to be a part of these discussions.
Yeah, just to share with you what the Satish Kumar from Schumacher College was asked to talk at the London School of Economics, and he went in there and he asked them, apparently, where is your ecology department? So they said, oh no, this is a school of economics, we don't have an ecology department. And so this is what Satish asked. Well, the word economics comes from oikos, and it means management. Oikos is a Greek word meaning home, and it means management of the home. And ecology also comes from the same root word, oikos, but it means knowledge of the home. It is, how can you manage the home without knowledge of the home?
Claude, in your talk, you said that we need to be allowing our children to do what they want to do. And I'd say the same logic can go for adults as well. Allow them to do what they want to do. But in this world where economics, the paradigm of economics is defining people's wants and creating them to be addicts, and our children to be screen addicts, how can we protect them from that if they're allowed to do what they want to do?
No, this is a problem not today itself. It's a problem much earlier, even when TV and all these things first began to come into India, and people really were having difficulties with keeping their children from TV screens, and this problem is there all the time. But the words that I use is, you give children, you protect children's right to choose what they want to do. It's different from just allowing them to do what they want to do. That's a liberal thing that, I do what I want to do. I have no, I don't bother about the rest of society. I'm an individual. I have got my own rights. I've got my individual rights, and I will everything has to cater to that and to my needs and so on. That's a very Western concept. In India, we don't have that concept at all. I mean, we don't think that, children will disrespect their elders. They will hurt animals. They will make fun of people who have got disabilities, and there are things, there are norms which all human beings follow, and I've seen that in most children. If you give them, the thing is that if you give them that trust, you trust them, they are able to respond. I have seen that, for example, parents telling their children not to watch television, but themselves watching television is again something that is not at all acceptable, because you are doing something, but you don't want your child to do it. Now, the child understands that you are doing something which is good for you, but it's bad for me. Now, how can it be possible? So they know that there are different standards. You have to have the same standards. And honesty, which children need to face from their parents, that honesty is never available. Secondly, it's time. Time is not made available to children, because we like to get rid of them as soon as possible. We like to put them into that bus so they go to school, so that they don't make any demands on our time. Somebody else can look after the nuisance. And when they come back, anyway, we are too exhausted, so we say, go and watch the television. And then we literally expose them to all sorts of things. Now, we brought up our three boys without a television set all the time that they grew up. But we gave them an interesting childhood. We gave them an interesting childhood of being able to do what they wanted to do. One fellow was interested in snakes, one fellow was interested in something else, a third fellow was interested in computers or what. We gave them the freedom to work with it. And they had the total freedom to work with, not us looking at the shoulder, what are you doing now? Are you doing this? Are you looking at this program which is not, you know, we gave them total freedom. And because of that trust and freedom, they turned out to be normal individuals. I mean, I'm not saying that they are extraordinarily gifted individuals or whatever. They're all gainfully employed, but they never, till today, violated our trust. Because people say, oh, you leave your children at tomorrow in Goa. They'll be having drugs. They'll be, doing all sorts of other things. But we never found them at any time, you know, taking to drugs or anything of the sort. Because not that we policed them. We didn't want this idea of policing your children is totally, totally, totally wrong, because it really expresses that you have become the state yourself. You know, instead of having a policeman, you have become the policeman. You are trying to see whether he does right or wrong according to your circumstance. So if you have genuine care, you have genuine time, and you are really committed. There's one girl here who is with her daughter. Where is she? Is she here? She says, I'm committed to this for next 40 years, and I'm taking your advice seriously that for next 40 years I'm not going to work, I'm going to look after this girl. Now that's remarkable, because she will see that the child gets that freedom. Now if you look at our families in the time that we were young, we had 11 children in our family. Our father and mother never knew where we were most of the time. You see, today you have parents who have just got one child. So that one child has got six pairs of eyes watching him. Mother, father, and also grandfather or grandmother. And the whole thing is degenerated into a series of you don't do this, you don't do that, you don't watch this, you don't go, you don't go out, you'll fall down, you break your legs, you'll do this, you'll do that. It's a continuous, you know, lecture of, you know, what you should do. Now that breaks down. That breaks down the relationship. And that child is want to go soon to get out of the house, wants to go out somewhere. I've got boys who just don't want to leave our house. I mean, we are very happy. It's because so many people who come and complain, our children are going to Australia, they don't look at us anymore, they don't send us an email. I say, why did you send them there in the first place? But here you got people who don't want to leave the house because they are free. They are treated with full respect. There is no probing. There is no, you can stay till you have, after all, what are parents for? You are supposed to give them the best in life and give them whatever they require in terms of what they literally want to do in terms of getting some happiness. And you got only one person. Why do you have the worries of a parent when there were 11 children? 11 children, I could understand. But the porridge vessel in our house, by the time it went from my eldest brother to came to me, I had only the crumbs at the end of the utensil. And I developed an insane liking for porridge from that day. After that, anybody gives me porridge is a lifelong friend of mine. But that is the deprivation I felt at that time. Because, you know, this is the... Today, the parent has got only one golden apple in front of him. And they can give him all the love and the care, but they don't have the time. They say, no, I've got to come, I've got to work, I've got to 6 hours, I've got to stay 8 hours, I've got to do this, I've got to, I've got no time for you. And then, of course, you are literally handing over the child to all sorts of other characters who will then take over. But that, you are not supposed to do that as a parent. You are supposed to be there to protect the child, not to put things in his head, but to protect the child from harm. And harm means spiritual harm, all other types of harm, and even this type of harm where, you know, you create a huge bridge between you and your child. Then what hope do you have got? You got no hope after that. Say bye-bye. Go.
Hi. So my question is to Claude, sir. Sir, you told us to move away from formal education. So why were you formally educated? And also, are your children formally educated? And I study in Azim Prince University. So if I quit now, so what do I do?
No, thank you. Thank you for that question. Very specifically, I went to school when I was young because At that time, it was the done thing. And a school at that time was much more relaxed than it is today. And we were taught all sorts of innocent things, so we went through it. I mean, I don't think that I am scarred by my school, by in the way in which children today are scarred by my school. So today I would take a different approach in terms of sending my children to school, because when you see the degeneration of the schooling system outside, it's really, you know, hazardous to send your child anymore to these type of institutions. And very often the person who's sending the child to school is in the normal parameters more educated than the teacher in the school. So, I mean, why is it that you normally always send your child to the best teacher? You don't send the child to somebody who is less, you know, equipped than you to be able to teach that child. All my three sons went to school, all went to school, and they also went to college, despite our best advice. But what we did, and this is again something that was accidental, and this is advice that I give you, is we encourage them not to learn what is being taught in the school and in the college. So we told them that any person with a normal intelligence would be able to pass any examination in a school. And nowadays in Goa, we have this policy where everybody is passed till they are 10th standard, no problem. You fail, pass, it's not a problem. Because after the internet and so on, you really don't need any teachers. You don't need any universities also, because you know, if you want the latest information today, you don't go to your professor, because he'll use his notes of 40 years old. You'll get the latest paper on the subject, you know, as of yesterday. So that situation is, you know, also completely transformed. But so we gave them that advice: don't study, because if you study this, it will damage your brain. Do what you want to do in those 3 to 4 years. Make a lot of girlfriends. Sit in the canteen. The principal objected to the canteen. He said that, you know, your sons, you are such well-known people. What will it be if your sons, you know, fail or, you know, come out in the first 500? We said we'll be very happy if they come up in the first 500. We are not interested in them coming up in the first 10 or first 20 or whatever it is. And eventually it all worked out very well. I mean, even their professors came and helped them to fudge their attendance data in the... My eldest son passed off his BSc project papers for his MSc on my advice. I only says change the dates. So they changed the dates and he got through, because nobody reads these things. The invigilators are all bogus. They are only collecting money on the number of papers there. So why the hell do you worry about these things? My wife and I are both first class first under that impression. We are both first class first in the entire school record college. Up to university, we both fought for the gold medal in Bombay University in our masters, and both of us got the same marks in Bombay University, she in history, I in philosophy. But till today, not a single person over the last 50 years has ever asked me, where is your degree? So why people are obsessed with this paper, I don't understand. Nobody ever asked me, show me a degree. You know, that you have passed, or you've done your MA, or you've done your PhD, or so. Nobody really asked me any of this. So I thought this obsession is really difficult. So even my sons, I said, you see, go, do whatever you want. You want to get certified, get certified. But don't mistake the certification for the content of what you're going. And remember that this is the best time of your life. 16 to 25, when all your hormones are kicking, when everybody, every woman looks like, you know, Raveena Tandon, and everything. This is the time you develop all the friendships and relationships you want. Don't waste your time on studying some third class fellow from Sussex who has written a book on political science in 1837. Don't read that. I mean, it's really nothing that is going to help you at all. It may help your professor to get a salary, but it's not going to help you at all to move in life. They followed that example very well. For all the 3 years, they did whatever they wanted. And they sat for the exam and all came out second class. No problem. But they, at the end of it, they were all employable. They were all, today, my youngest son, I didn't know this, his American friend for whom he was doing contracts came and said, do you know, because the son got married, so he had come for the weddings. He said, do you know what your son does? So we said, we don't know. We know what my eldest son does. He used to catch snakes and birds and all, and he's still doing it. Middle son, he's a musician and keeps people happy in restaurants and so on. So third son, they said, do you know what he does? We had not even gone into his room. We have no idea what he does. So he said, he designs, the Goan boy, he designs the application for our company to run the entire construction movement of construction trucks, repair work in all American roads. And this guy is, you know, below 30. And we never knew. The Indian government cannot use him. The Goa government cannot use him. Unfortunately, he's used by some American company. And he never goes to America. He just does it on his computer sitting in his house. But because we allowed, said 3 years, please do your computers. You want to do computers, go and do it. But he said, they're teaching us Foxbase and DBase in the college. So I went to ask the college, why are you teaching in Foxbase? And this is all gone. These programs are all gone. They said, but the university is not willing to change the syllabus. So then I made arrangement, like a good parent, I made arrangement for him to work in a computer shop with a friend of mine so that he would be able to get the skills. And at the end of 3 years, he could run a computer program, but none of his colleagues who had gone 3 years in college and studied the same subjects could do that, those type of programs. So allow them, come out, you go to the university, go to Azim Premji, they are the best university there after Bhumi, and get certified, but do what you want and what learning you want to do, and twist the professors to come around to your point of view, and what you want to learn.
Yeah. Oh, I just want to quickly answer that last thing you said, which is, if I quit, what do I do? You know, I think like we wouldn't ask such a question if we had not been deprived of time to have conversations to all kinds of people, or you know, like sit in canteens, like Claude said, and chat with girlfriends, boyfriends, whoever. You know, do a lot of wasting of time. Now, we are not allowed to waste time in school and college, or what we do, we end up doing sometimes stupid things rather than, you know, real good waste of time. So when you say this, you know, it means to me that the system has robbed you of your imagination. That to ask a question, if I quit, what will I do? Tell me, to somebody, you know. So if I were seriously to answer the question, I wouldn't like to prescribe, but yet if I were to in this short time, I would say take a gap year, roam around, waste time, explore, and you will find what you want to do. I think all of us have been brainwashed by this idea of don't waste time, and therefore when we don't waste time, we don't really discover what is meaningful to us. We have only, you know, the head is so programmed, I can only relate to that.
Do you think that Rabindranath Tagore would have got a Nobel Prize had he not quit school at the age of 13?
I'm Seema. My question is, what mistakes have you people made in your life and you would not like younger generation to repeat? And what is your message for us?
I think just as the topic of the conversation, I did my bachelor's and immediately rushed into my master's, and largely because I got a massive scholarship and I didn't want to give that up. But in hindsight, I would have liked to probably travel a lot more in the Northeast, which I was initially planning to do, go and teach various things there and so on. So I think the fact that I couldn't take a break is something I regret, but then I've more than compensated for it afterward. So I travel a lot now. Finding a workplace which is flexible enough, which can give you time to travel, and which understands and balances their needs versus yours, I think is kind of important. And the place that I work at, I can take off 2 months at a stretch and just travel.
So yeah, I said that I couldn't share anything about education because it was a failure. Maybe you want to hear about the failure. I thought of Henry's question, and I wanted to add something, but there is a lot of other answers being given. I thought actually one thing, which is community. So besides, you know, students and parents and teachers, there is also the rest of the community. I tried, because when I got concerned as a parent to get involved with my kids' education, to participate in a community-based education experiment, And it failed because I think as the adults involved, we didn't acknowledge power, and we thought that we were like above that, you know. It's like we're all very idealist, and we're all here for the good cause and for the next generation and so forth. And we didn't spend enough time on what does a community actually mean in terms of governance and decision making, and being inclusive yet also moving forward in a certain direction. I do feel this is the way that I'm making sense of it. If you ask somebody else who went through that same experience, they will probably say something different. But I did try to bring this topic up again and again and say, hey, you know, there are people that feel left out. I don't think we can continue until we address that. But then there was tomorrow, and you know, 40 kids were coming tomorrow, so you know, we couldn't close the school for too long. But yeah, I think it's a failure that I've lived through, which is recent, so it's very alive for me. But it's a collective failure. I also have an individual failure, which is I thought I could beat the system and started a private limited company and accepted equity funding because they're all talking about social impact investment. So I thought, hey, you know, this is a way where we can beat them at their own game. And then I thought if I could make farmers the shareholders of the company, then the consumer rupee would immediately flow to the farmers, and then we could jig the playing field. And I didn't understand how deep this disconnect between the money and real life was. And I thought, oh, I'm a young person. I started this company when I was 27. You know, these people probably know a lot better, so I'll hand over the decision to them. And that was a very big mistake, because then they put the CEO who had a track record and responsibility in some completely unrelated field, but they were like, yeah, whatever. You know, he managed Vodafone cell towers somewhere. He can manage organic cotton. You know, it's just another P&L thing on a balance sheet. So I guess the mistake I made was not to trust myself enough. And it can be really overwhelming. You know, if you have this entire system around you where people are so confident and they think they know what they're doing, actually they don't, and the system is completely, you know, sick. So I actually thought, when we were talking about data on ecosystem services, I'm a big believer in helplessness right now, and of not knowing. I think we've overestimated our capacity to actually understand what on earth is going on. To dwell a little bit more in despair and helplessness is that's something that we're doing right now. We're holding climate grief circles. So anybody wants to come to a climate grief circle, you're very welcome in Orville. But yeah, those are the two regrets that are top of my mind. I'm sure there are more, but we can talk about it.
Too many failures to talk about here. I'll just mention one. I think I took books too seriously. I still do, in some corner of my brain. Bad karma. Here's what I think now, and here's what I would say to young people now. Of all the things that you live, okay, you feel but a fraction. Of all the things that you feel, you can think a fraction. Of all the things that you can think, you can speak a fraction. Of all the things that you can speak, you can write a fraction. That's how insignificant a thing writing actually is. But given that we live in a verbocentric or a logocentric world defined by the modern West, unfortunately, we're all caught in this whirl of words and thoughts. And we forget to feel, we forget to experience, we forget to sense, we forget to live directly without words. I mean, to me, the primordial languages of humanity are music and dance. There's nothing quite as important as music and dance, as far as I can tell, both in the ancient world and in today's world.
what it takes to move us, to shake ourselves out of our habits, to shake us off our sloth, not our sloth. Sloth is a good thing, sloth is a bad thing. There's a W in the sloth. So what it takes to get us moving is actually music and dance, because we are basically waves. Even physicists now have come to that wisdom. We are basically waves in disguise. So if that's the nature of a human being, just like it's the nature of every other being, why can't we stay loyal to that? And how much of that wave are you going to experience by looking at the dead letter on a printed page? You know, it's cold print. Cold print is the right word for it. There's no warmth in it. How much effort it takes to wake us up in our hearts to the warmth of a human experience. It's very hard, increasingly hard, because we are deluged by words today. And we have got it exactly wrong, which is to say, if you can't put it in words, it doesn't exist. Or if it's not on Google, it doesn't exist, which is even worse. It's so brutally reductionist and stupid. It's basically the source of the infantilization of humanity today, as far as I can tell, cognitively speaking. And the longer that this system lasts, the digitized system lasts, I think the faster we will get infantilized, because the technologies that are working to draw us downhill, the digital gravitation, is just going to destroy whatever natural cognitive intelligence human beings are given. I don't think we are that smart as a species. I don't think that's true. I think there are species much smarter than us in so many dimensions, some which we acknowledge, some which we are not smart enough to notice. So the stupidization of our species is what I see going on. And unfortunately, the most powerful technologies created by humanity have ironically and paradoxically been deployed for the very purpose of idiotizing us, because unless we are idiotized, we can't be turned from human beings into consumers, and without that, the system cannot run.
Well, there are a lot of things, a lot of mistakes that one has done all through. In fact, sometimes I wonder what good we have done. I think it's difficult to find out what good one has done. But surely the work that I do now for the last 20-30 years is something that gives me a lot of satisfaction, and I can tell you I sleep well.
Yeah, where I live in Goa, most people think that I'm the biggest mistake. Anyway, the biggest mistakes that I have done, and there are many which are too embarrassing to relate here, and you may laugh at me, so I won't tell them at all. But the biggest one that I made was when I got my PhD and came back to India and went to, you know, work in a village in the foot of the Western Ghats. And I said that, okay, now I have a PhD, I have all this sort of thing, and my wife and I went there and said that let's go and help these village people, because we had always that idealism that we must go and live in a village and help people to live in a village to improve their material prospects or whatever it is. So we went with that spirit to a farm and purchased a farm, worked there for 3 to 4 years, and made all the possible mistakes that somebody should, or people of that education do make. I mean, we had absolutely no connection with the village community, and ultimately we had to, close the farm because we had completely failed. Means all our animals got disease, like foot and mouth disease, and there was no help from anybody. And as far as the village was concerned, we were there for 4 or 5 years. Maybe we gave them jobs in our farm to do, and so on. But in terms of what we wanted to achieve, it was a zero. And I would never, ever think of doing something like that again. After that, I live still in a village. Not that I've given up the village. I still live in a village only, but in another village closer to the town of Mapsa, where I still live with very ordinary people who buy, people who whitewash houses, and people who cultivate their fields, and people who do all sorts of other small village jobs. And there we no longer think, and that's been my greatest learning, we no longer really think that we have got something to teach them. As a matter of fact, we have become equal members. They teach us, and we help them whenever they want. If they need something to be done in some legal office or something, to type some letters, and so we do all those type of things. But if we want certain things done, then we go to them, and they help us out. So it's a very strange thing, because normally intellectuals and people with PhDs congregate in universities and cities and live among themselves and discuss things. But here we have, my wife is also a master's and she's also a lawyer. And we both live in this village, which is really most people who have not gone beyond their SSC in that sense, village schools, and still remarkable individuals, because that has made us see that people in the countryside are, in that sense, adults. They've had an adult education without going to university. They have a lifetime of experience. They have survived without government subsidies. They have survived without government doles. And they have born children. Those children have also come up in a certain sense. And that has given us an enormous amount, which we didn't have when we first went with the presumption that that we would be able to help. And I think that I tried to describe our experience. You know, when we were sitting in the village under the banyan tree, and I still remember it now visually enough to tell you about it. From the corner of my eye, I could see a small little, you know, whirl developing. You know, you see sometimes, you know, a short twist of wind coming, and the leaves suddenly move up because they're all disturbed. And it goes on and goes on out of your sight, and afterwards it disappears, and the leaves fall down to the ground, and everything is quiet again. And that was exactly, you could describe our movement, our staying in that village for 5 years. We were that small little world that came, created some sort of a thing, and after we went, we no longer existed. So that's, I think, if you look at it in terms of mistakes, it's actually a learning. After that, we were never the same again.
You see, when I was young, I mean, 30s, 40s, 20s, whatever, I had this thing in my mind, I want to do all kinds of interesting things in life. But there was that insecurity, because I was also a lot more, I mean, today I feel there are so many people into alternatives and everything. And from the small town I came from, Coimbatore, like, I was a total oddball, and there were hardly one or two people with whom I can talk about what life meant to me, what I want to do, and they also got transferred out. You know, I was alone with my dreams and everything. And I somehow became insecure and saying, oh, I must do some basics in terms of earning a living, then I will do, you know. So it took me almost till I was 42, 43 years old before I tried to do something. I'm not saying by the time, I think much as Aseem was talking about, I was too much into books. In a way, I was too much into books, but also into, you know, this thing of I should do this to my, you know, the insecurity part, as in have my basics, have a roof above my head, and that kind of a thing. And that is a kind of a regret later, because much later I come across many people who just ventured out and got started with something. And yeah, today in today's world, money is needed to do a lot of things, but money came to them and somehow they managed. I feel I've lost out on good 20 years of time. Not that I had too many regrets, because I chose to work with a family organization where I had a lot of freedom. Freedom to travel to wilderness areas and meet interesting people, and especially spend a lot of time on one kind of work which I really love, which again everybody thought is weird, which is about what we call process work, which is now evolved into inner and outer ecology, self-exploration programs and things like that, and which is really trying to look at underlying processes everywhere. So I had fun during that time, but I think I would have had more fun if I had been, you know, more courageous too. So I hope there is a big lesson in it for all you young people out there. Don't waste time like me. Waste time in good ways, you know. So that's it. We'll have to close now. Thank you very much. Thank you to all our panelists.